Have you ever been sitting on a bumpy, crowded bus full of mysterious smells and wondered to yourself, why do we even smell things in the first place? What makes some things smell really good or bad? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
Smells are nothing more than teeny tiny little particles floating in the air around us that we suck up through our nostrils. That odor-filled air heads right up your nasal passages in your nose, where the odor molecules are finally trapped by a thin bit of tissue called olfactory epithelium. These special nerve cells are covered in cilia, which are like tiny hairs that stick out and trap the smell particles as they float past. The cells then send a signal directly to your brain, telling it what different smells are entering your nose. Most pungent odors, both nice and nasty, tend to be made up of lots of different odor molecules that mix together to create the distinct smell we recognize. Every single time you breathe in through your nose, the olfactory epithelium is alerted, and the process starts again, over and over, all day long. Most of the time, whether or not we think something smells comes down to memory. Our brains are great at remembering certain smells and associating them with good or bad memories. For instance, your absolute favorite meal might smell mouthwatering to you, but stinky to someone else who's never tried it before. That's why there's so many smells out there that some people love and others can't stand. Okay, so most of the time our memories help us decide if something smells good or bad, but what about the rest of the time? Why are there some smells that seem to automatically make us gag? Well, it just comes down to pure instinct. Take blood, for example. Both the sight and the smell of blood is well known to repel animals who are prey, like deer, rabbits, and, yeah, humans. Even if you've never smelled blood before, it's likely to make you squeamish right away. But to predatory animals like wolves or tigers, blood smells tasty. So we tend to steer clear of places that smell bloody and might be full of predators. There's other, more obvious examples too, like poop. It's super unhealthy to touch poop, so our sense of smell tells us from day one to stay clear. The same is true for lots of things that might get you sick too. Like rotting food, for instance. That rotting smell is really just the smell of dangerous bacteria breaking down the cells of the food and releasing an icky chemical called hydrogen sulfide. This toxic stench smells so bad that it makes you want to stay far away, making the stink of our old, unhealthy food bad enough that you'd never consider eating it, even if you don't have the memories to back it up. So when someone tells you to just trust your instincts, you can confidently tell them, "I already do." Just don't expect them to know what you're talking about. Have you ever been extra super hungry and seen or smelled some delicious food and felt your mouth begin to water? What is that? Why does our mouth water when we're hungry? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
We all recognize the telltale signs of hunger. Pangs in your stomach, maybe a growl or two, endless cravings for the food you love, and, of course, salivation. In order to understand why our mouths water, we first need to know what drool actually does. Saliva actually helps us digest our food. It's the very first stage of breaking down the food we eat. Spit is made mostly of water, but there's less than 1% of it that's made up of proteins, lipids, and electrolytes. All that stuff helps to break down the food you're chewing up before it gets to your belly. So, why do our mouths water when we're hungry? Because when we see a food we really want to eat, we start to imagine what it would taste like. Our body reacts to those thoughts by prepping us to eat, and a big part of that preparation is producing saliva to help us chow down. You see, every time you smell, see, or even imagine eating food when you're hungry, our brains send a signal to the medulla oblongata. That's the part of the brain that controls things you do without thinking, like breathing, pumping blood, and, yes, salivating. The medulla oblongata starts to prep for the big meal you're imagining, and almost instantly your mouth will start to water even without you noticing. So, in other words, your mouth begins to water because, well, it's time to eat.
Ice cream, you scream, we all scream for brain freeze. Have you ever wondered why cold treats give us splitting headaches in the first place?
Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
It doesn't matter if you call it a cold headache, an ice cream headache, or a brain freeze, it's all the same sinister sensation. As you've probably learned the hard way, brain freeze happens when you eat or drink something super cold too fast. You see, every time you put food in your mouth, that food comes in contact with the roof of your mouth called the palate. When we gobble down something frigid too fast, the nerves in our palate send a message to the brain, basically saying, "Help! Suddenly it's freezing cold!" This causes blood vessels in the brain to suddenly swell and shrink, which causes the throbbing sensation we call brain freeze. Okay, so that's what causes brain freeze, but there's still one big unanswered question. How do you avoid it, and can you stop it once it starts? Well, the best way to avoid an ice cream headache is obvious. Eat your ice cream slower. But since it's not always an option, there's always a cure for brain freeze once it starts. Press your tongue against the roof of your mouth and hold it there until the pain subsides. Okay, now go eat as much ice cream as is humanly possible! If you've ever stepped outside on a cold day or watched a spine-tingling scary movie, you've probably experienced goosebumps. But have you ever wondered why we get goosebumps in the first place? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
You can call them goosebumps, goose pimples, or goose flesh. They're all the same thing. Little bumps that form on your skin when you're cold or when you experience strong emotions like excitement or fear. They're a reflex, which means that you can't make yourself get them. They just happen automatically. That reflex has a fancy scientific name. It's called the pilomotor reflex, and it's not just humans who have it. Porcupines and sea otters, for instance, have the same reflex, raising their quills or hairs when they're scared or sense danger. Okay, so we know what causes us to get goosebumps, but why? Why do we have a goosebump reflex, and why does it cause little bumps on our skin? Well, the reason why isn't all that different from our porcupine and sea otter friends. You see, when you're cold or afraid, your brain sends signals to all the muscles in your body, basically saying, "Alert! Alert!" That signal causes all your muscles to react by tensing up, and the little teeny tiny muscles in your skin attached to the base of your hairs also tense up, causing them to stand on end, and a little bit of skin around the hair bulges like a flexing muscle. And just like that, your arms are covered in goosebumps. Oh, and you might be wondering, why do we call them goosebumps, pimples, or flesh? Because, well, they look like the skin of a bird whose feathers have been plucked like a goose. Makes sense, right? Gulp down a big glass of water and maybe try holding your breath, because today's question is timeless. Why do we get hiccups?
Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
People have always wondered why we hiccup. And throughout history, we've come up with some pretty wild stories to explain them. The ancient Greeks believed that hiccups were violent emotions erupting from the body, like a cork popping from a bottle. In some Slavic and Hungarian folklore, people only get hiccups when someone somewhere else is talking about them. And in some Indian and Arabic folklore, you just get them when someone who cares about you is thinking of you from far away. Nowadays, experts look for more scientific explanations. Evidence points to spasms in a muscle called the diaphragm. It's the big muscle between your chest and abs that helps you breathe. When it spontaneously spasms, it causes us to take in a quick breath of air. The sudden rush of air causes a flap inside your throat called the epiglottis to shut, interrupting the quick breath and causing the sound that makes a hiccup. Okay, so spasms in the diaphragm cause hiccups, but what causes the diaphragm to spasm in the first place? Well, that could be caused by an overly full stomach, eating unhealthy foods, eating too quickly, or by sudden changes of temperature inside the stomach. Hiccups can even be caused by strong emotions like excitement, shock, or fear. That's why sometimes a sudden jump scare can cure your hiccups. Bah! Sorry, I had to try. Speaking of cures, there's lots of possible remedies out there, but no surefire solution. Maybe the most common cure for hiccups is also the sweetest. A spoonful of sugar. Or if sweet isn't your thing, maybe try sour with a spoonful of vinegar instead. Not into that? Then try peanut butter, hot sauce, honey, or even powdered chocolate. If you'd rather not gobble down spoonfuls of food, try breathing slowly and deeply into a brown bag. Or just take big, slow gulps of water. And if those don't work, maybe this will help! Ever been bundled up on a blistery winter morning and wondered, why do we shiver when we're cold? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions!
Whenever we get cold, our teeth start to chatter and our bodies start to shake uncontrollably in order to keep us warm. You see, the inside of our bodies needs to stay at a certain temperature in order to work right. When it's cold out, our temperature drops and our bodies spring into action to keep us warm and toasty inside. The normal temperature for a human is around 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit, so anytime the air is colder than that, we're technically losing heat. When it's cold enough to make us shiver, we're losing so much heat that our body reacts to automatically keep itself warm. Okay, so that's why we shiver, but why the shaking and chattering? How does that warm us up? Well, when you shiver, it might feel like you're just shaking in your boots, but actually, your muscles are tightening and relaxing over and over and over again, super fast. All that muscle movement gives off heat, which warms you back up, at least enough to keep you healthy. Usually, when your muscles move and produce heat, it's an inconvenient byproduct, and actually leads to sweating as a way to cool you down. But when you're cold, that energy from muscle movement is finally put to good use. So why do you shiver? Because your body is really good at taking care of itself, even when you don't.